going to be teaching you about still life drawing. A still life is a set of stationary objects that an artist might draw as a practice to hone observational drawing skills or as a way of capturing a moment in time. So today we'll look at some historical and contemporary examples of still lives or artists drawing still lives. We will teach you how to set up your own composition, and we'll think about some specific drawing techniques that are useful when drawing a still life.
Still life painting had a surge in popularity in the 17th century, a religious age characterized by the belief that life was essentially preparation for the afterlife. Called Vanitas or Memento Mori, translation, remember, you must die. These still lives were highly coded. Each object had symbolic meaning and was carefully chosen. Objects like skulls, extinguished candles, pocket watches were meant to act as a reminder of our mortality. Fruits and flowers, objects that were full of life but inherently temporal, were also popular. Can you find any of those objects in this painting? This trompe l'oeil, work by Dutch artist Cornelius Norbertus Gijsbrechts. Now that is a name. The painting appears to be peeling away from its support, building on a theme of decay. Still lifes can also act as portraits of a time, giving us a clue to the values or beliefs of the artist or recipient. Manny Farber, a painter and film critic, spent most of his artistic career painting still lifes. Farber said that his art was an act of both observing and being in the world. His paintings often reference films, dreams, conversations, though those messages remain a secret. They capture the ephemeral and reorient the viewer to oftentimes overlooked scenes. As we begin to prepare our own still life compositions, consider, what might your objects say about you? What might they tell a viewer about this moment that we're living through?
Giorgio Morandi was an Italian painter who worked with simple vessels and a muted color palette. His compositions often involve placing objects right next to each other so that their edges just touch but do not overlap. It is almost as if the objects share their edges. In this first painting, the composition really catches your eye. Morandi was very careful with the placement of his objects. The white bottle he has placed in the front lines up perfectly with the other objects and also slightly blocks them. This vase feels like it squeezes right into the space it has been placed in. Morandi was a master at making unique and contemplative still life compositions out of his collection of simple objects. In the second painting, you will notice that the objects are lined up carefully, with the edges just touching, as mentioned before. This is interrupted by abruptly placing a tall, more uniquely shaped vessel right in front of these perfectly aligned objects. Holly Coulis is a Canadian painter who plays with perspective in her still life paintings. She flattens shapes that our eye would usually recognize as round or having dimension. This gives her paintings a very graphic feeling, almost like they are made of cutout shapes. Her paintings also use imaginative or enhanced color and outlines to create a fantastical and original take on the classic still life genre. Her paintings deal with geometry, symmetry, and repetition. Holly's playful paintings oftentimes feel invented and abstracted by the artist. You'll notice that she often chooses to line objects up so that they just barely touch, kind of similar to Morandi's work. However, in Holly's paintings, she does this by repeating objects or mirroring them rather than using different objects next to each other. Yet in some of her paintings, like Pineapple and Coffees, none of the objects touch.
All right, everyone. So we've just talked about some artists with you, and now we want to get started setting up our own compositions. So what we want you to do now is to gather some objects for your still life. We want you to think about gathering a variety of different objects. So some objects that are wide, some objects that are tall, some objects that are soft, some with hard edges. Think about different types of objects and different types of sizes to give your still life a variety. We just looked at Holly Kulis's work, and you may have noticed in some of her still lives, she puts smaller objects in the foreground, which is the front of the image, and some taller or larger objects in the background. So when we're thinking about setting up our still life, we do want to think about how we organize things. If you put a large object in the foreground, that's fine, but think about if it's blocking most of your objects, if you're not really seeing many objects when you're drawing. I would like to use this candlestick in my still life, and it makes me think back to Mirandi's work where he used some objects that are really skinny but tall in the foreground. And that's great because it actually creates these moments of overlap where these objects interact with one another. So you could definitely use something tall and skinny in the foreground to create those nice moments of overlap. We also want you to think about how you're gonna set up your still life. So do you want there to be symmetry? Have it be the same on both sides? Or do you maybe want to create one side that's really full of lots of objects and one side that doesn't have quite as many objects and is lighter and gives your eyes a moment to rest? So start thinking about how you might want to set up your still life. It definitely helps to kind of move things around, step back, look at it multiple times. So let's gather some objects and we'll get started.
Choosing objects that made different shapes, different textures. When you go to draw your still life, you're gonna wanna take the same care in setting up your composition on your page that you did setting up the composition of your actual still life. So the first major part of that is deciding the angle that you're gonna draw from. Is it right in the middle? Is it taking up the whole space? Are you gonna crop any of it? Perhaps you're zooming in on a section. Perhaps you have it off to one side. So with the same kind of care that you used to set up the composition of your still life, you also need to set up the composition on your paper. Whatever you choose, make sure that you are comfortable where you're drawing. You want to have a direct view. You don't want to have to be turning your head to the side to draw your still life. We're going to start out by making a gesture drawing, which is a really nice way of getting familiar with your still life, of finding and mapping the relationships between the objects in your still life. So you might think about how one thing overlaps with another. You might think about scale. You might think about what's in the front and what's behind. It's really about getting to know or seeing the relationships between the objects. Now, a gesture drawing is not exhaustive. You're not gonna be thinking about little details like texture or color. You're really thinking about the whole form and the relationships. Now, while it's not exhaustive, and it is a way of just laying in the space, it is important to get into the habit of drawing what you see. I think actually looking and recording what it is you see is probably the hardest part of drawing. Because a lot of times our mind plays tricks on us, and especially if you're drawing an object that's familiar to you, you might be able to do it right with your eyes closed. However, today we're practicing observing. And that's something just to keep in mind. I think about it a lot like meditation. If you meditate, it's this idea of constantly drawing your focus back to what you're doing and really paying attention to what is right in front of you. Mm-hmm. things to note about my gesture drawing here. Notice I use this loose searching line, and that's so I could go over forms really easily and layer them. You might have noticed there were even moments where I drew a line through another thing. And I can also replicate that motion with my pencil here, right? Like I might line up the bottom of that amber jar to the bottom of the marble mortar and see that it falls just a little bit in front of it in terms of the base, but the top intersects with it. You also probably noticed that I didn't start over here and finish one area and then move my way across. I kind of worked on the whole drawing simultaneously, and that is another way of assuring that those relationships are consistent, right? And you might have noticed I ran into a little problem up here. I couldn't fit that lemon, this one. So if you're working the whole drawing at the same time, it's less likely that you're gonna run out of space or something.
All right, everyone. So Sarah just walked you through gesture drawing, and now I wanna walk you through a different type of observational drawing. We're gonna be talking about contour drawing. Contour drawing deals with the outline or the edges of our objects, and it's kind of a slower process where we're really trying to pick up on all the intricacies of these objects. The gesture drawing was kind of the main idea or their essence, and now we want to really get down those little details and really be observing super carefully. So while you're drawing, I want you to think as though your eye and your hand are moving in unison. So say I'm drawing this lemon. As I'm drawing this top edge of the lemon, my hand should be moving exactly the same spot as my eye. So I want it to be as if my hand is actually tracing this object. That's gonna allow you to really get in those little details within the object, which is what we wanna do here with contour drawing. I also want you to think about drawing what you see rather than what you think you know. So let me explain what I mean. When we think about a leaf in our head, we might think about this perfect object that doesn't have any little holes or ridges to it. And that's not really the case usually, and especially not with my kumquat here. The leaves are kind of dying and curling up. So when I'm drawing this, I'm gonna wanna get all these little bumps and curves because that's important in describing what my object looks like. So again, drawing what you see rather than what you think you know about an object. That's gonna be really important. I wanna show you one more thing before we get started with our contour drawing, and it's measuring. So say I wanna draw this lemon and I wanna draw it in, in comparison, understanding the relationship to this can of soda water. I can look at the two and kind of try to see, oh, the lemon looks like it's like half the height, but we can actually do this more accurately with measuring. So what you'll do is you'll take your pencil, and the tip of your pencil should be lined up with the top of your object. I could also measure the width. I don't have to measure the height, but for this, I'm gonna do the height. So I'm lining my pencil up with the very top of the object, and then my thumb I'm gonna place at the very bottom of the object, and then I'm gonna get the size. But it's really important that you're not actually measuring right up close to it. You're holding your arm out in a straight line like this. And the reason for that is, say I measure one object and I put my thumb here and this is the size, and then I'm like, oh, okay, I wanna measure this object. Well, now the pencil's way closer to my face, and this area is gonna look a lot larger to me than it did like this. So we wanna remain consistent. So I am going to measure this lemon in relation to this can of soda water. Okay. So I'm going to keep my arms straight, and I'm measuring this lemon, and then I'm gonna go to the can. One, two. All right, so what I found from my measuring is that the height of this lemon is about half of the can. So the can is like a little less than two lemons tall. So I can go back to my drawing, and now I have that information, and I can double check, is that what I have on my drawing? I can just use my fingers and double check if my can is twice as tall as the lemon. So now we're going to get started with contour drawing. So get your paper ready and a drawing tool, and we'll get working. And your still life objects, and then you can get started. Thank you so much for joining us.